That was gracious Jake with a follow-up by the pastor. Everyone is welcome to participate if your doctrine is sound and your conduct is reasonable. He was assuming that everyone here is of sound doctrine and reasonable conduct. I'm just, for those of you who... Okay. If you're not, come Saturday. Amen. All right, we will be out tomorrow afternoon, 4:30. Downtown, the other side will be out, so it'd be too bad if the devil's workers were more faithful than the Lord's workers. God help us with that. I know you can't be everywhere at one time, but you can be somewhere one time or another for the Lord. So, all right, 1 Timothy chapter 2 this evening, 1 Timothy chapter 2, simple little reminder Bible study message sort of thing here this evening. 1 Timothy 2, verse number 1. 1 Timothy 2, 1, I exhort therefore that, first of all, which is a funny thing to say after you've already written a whole chapter. wouldn't first of all be in chapter 1, verse 1, not chapter 2, verse 1? Anyway, I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. Now there's a period on top of a comma, semicolon there. So that's a full thought. Now another thought that goes with it. For kings and for all that are in authority, period, comma, another thought. That we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. Whereunto I am ordained a preacher and an apostle, I speak the truth in Christ and lie not, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and verity. I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands, without wrath and doubting. All right, Father, bless this portion of Scripture to our hearts tonight. Bless these men and women that made the effort to come and be here in a church service in the middle of the week. And some have come a long way, and really it took a lot to get here. I pray you'd bless all of us this evening from your word. In Jesus' name, and amen. All right, in the first verse, we have four types of prayers. In the second verse, so at the end of the first verse, in the second verse, we have the object or the persons for whom we are to be praying. In the third verse, we have the desire of God as it relates to those prayers in the third portion, verses 3 through 6. And then in verse number 7, we're reminded that Paul is a preacher of the gospel, and Paul has put prayer as the first order of business and preaching the gospel as the second order of business. And then in verse 8, we're told that we might be tempted to question whether or not God really wants us to do what we've just read, and that we might not want to do what we just read. And God says, no, you heard me right. I want you to do it. So let's take a look. Verse number 1, I exhort. I'm charging you, I'm coming as close to demanding this as I possibly can. First of all, that supplications, you see the word supply in there? That's asking God to provide what is needed. Asking God to provide what is needed. Now, we're not ruling out that verse 1 would take in, give us this day our daily bread. We're not ruling out that this verse would take in, God, give me the health and the strength to get through this day. We're not ruling out that this would take in, God, please provide for my family and so forth. But in the context, this is not me asking God to supply for me. This is God asking me to seek His face that He might supply the need of all men. You see that? First of all, supplications be made for all men. We really don't need too much of a command to pray for what we want or need. But we really do need God to remind us that our prayer closet shouldn't be our own private. The prayer list should have someone on it besides ourselves. Then he says, supplications, prayers. Now, aren't prayers prayers? I don't think so. Not as you read the verse. So we'll skip that one just for a moment. Intercessions. Jesus Christ, the Bible says he's our great high priest. He ever liveth to make intercession for us. And we teach that. We say this is what that means. I go to Jesus Christ and Jesus goes to God on my behalf. He's an intercessor. He prays to God for me. So what would intercessory prayer be? That would be me. I'm a priest. I'm not the great high priest. I'm not a high priest. But all believers are priests, the Bible says. That is me going to God on behalf of someone else. That is me going to God and praying for someone else. Now, notice this intercession is separate from supplications. So this isn't asking God, God, make sure that he's fed and make sure that she's well and make sure that they are comfortable. This is not me asking God to supply something for someone. This is me praying on behalf of another. There are people the devil wants to destroy. There are people the devil wants to take to hell. There are people the devil wants to drag out of church. There are people the devil wants to sidetrack into some heresy or another. You know why the Bible says, first of all, prayers, supplication, prayers, intercession, giving thanks? You know why he said do that first? Because when we see somebody slipping out of church, our first move is to talk about them. When we see somebody getting into some kind of heresy, our first move is to try and figure out how to out-argue them. When we see somebody going to hell, our first move is, I need to witness to them or preach to them. We certainly should, but that's not the first move. God's talking here about being the Savior of all men, and he's talking here about the Apostle Paul, a preacher, but he says, before we get to that, I need you to pray for people. We could tonight have long and lengthy conversations about all the terrible things that unsaved people do in the city of DeLand. Does our prayer time equal our talk about them time? Does our criticism of their practices time equal our intercession on their behalf time? God didn't say, first of all, I want you to talk about it. First of all, I want you to discuss the problem. First of all, I want you to make sure everybody agrees with you that they're really all that bad. The first thing I want you to do is pray for them. He said, well, I don't know if that's... Well, we'll show you just a minute. And the fourth type of prayer here is and giving of thanks. I wonder if God, and he wouldn't because he's gracious and he's merciful and all the things that he is, but I wonder if God answered a prayer or supplied something for me. I wonder if he didn't give me anything else until I said thank you for what he gave me. I wonder if my thank yous wouldn't pick up real quick. Well, I'll tell you something. When we're not well or we don't have food or we don't have a job or something's going wrong in the family, that supplication thing, it's automatic. But as soon as whatever was stirred up calms down, that giving of thanks, why isn't that as automatic? Nobody really has to tell us to ask God for what we perceive to be lacking. Nobody should have to ask us to thank God when he provides it. But giving of thanks is not really a big part. We didn't do it tonight, but in the average midweek service in a church, there'd be prayer time and prayer requests. Anybody got a prayer request? And there'll be 30 of those before anybody says, thank you, God, for anything. Now, shouldn't there be, a good hour of thank yous before we even get around to saying, and by the way, let's pray about this. If God doesn't do something we wanted him to do, he hears about it real quick. But when he does a million things every day that we didn't even ask him to do, there's really not a lot of thank yous going up. Okay, so if supplication, if that's asking for supply, for need, if intercession, if that's going to God on behalf of others, if giving of thanks, that's obvious, then what would prayers be? Wouldn't it just be talking to God? Just be talking to God. I think people have a hard time, like, you know, I just don't know how to pray. Do you have friends? Do you have family members? Are you married? I mean, if you have friends, then you don't just talk to people when you want something. Because if that's the only time you talk to people, you wouldn't have any friends. Our relationships aren't all gimme, gimme, I want, I don't have this, please. A lot of our relationships just talking. And prayer, you don't have to go to God because you want something. You don't have to go to God because you need something. Why not just talk to Him? Just fellowship with Him. It's an odd thing, isn't it? We don't have, most people don't have a problem conversing with people they're close to. We would say in theory, there's nobody closer to us than God. There's nobody means more to us than God. There's no one dearer to our heart than God. But we sure don't talk to Him much.
You're right.
You ever text Him? You ever call Him? You ever send Him an email? You see something, say, well, I got to tell so-and-so. Well, tell God. God, that's really pretty. I really like seeing that. God, are you seeing that right now? I'm sure He is. He made it. But you understand what I'm saying. We ought to be able to pray. Just talk to God. Don't just go to Him when you want something. Just go to Him, fellowship with Him. Praise the Lord. You could speak to Him in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Sing a song to the Lord. Riding down the road in a car, talk to God. Say, God, how come when there's two lanes, they go 70, and when there's one lane, they go 5? Shouldn't it be 35 when one lane's shut down? And just you and the Lord can talk about that. Sometimes, you know, really when you think about it, we don't act like God's a real living person. We say prayers, but are we talking to somebody? So, all right, now here's what he says. I exhort therefore that first of all, supplication, prayers, intercession, give thanks, be made for all saved men that you like. Well, we should do that. For all the people in your church, we should do that. But then God says, for kings and for all that are in authority. The man that wrote this is living under an emperor who's imprisoning and killing Christians. And the Holy Spirit said, the first thing I want you to do is pray for the king. First thing, pray for the king. Pray for everyone in authority. That would be who? The centurions, the generals, the tax collectors, the senators. The Holy Spirit has Paul write to Timothy and say, tell those church people, God wants them to pray not against, not about. Tell them He wants them to pray for the authority figures that are over them, both inside the church and outside the church. Now, I want to say this. I'm as guilty as anybody about what I'm about to say. But if everybody that's truly saved in America had spent 8 years praying for Obama as often as they criticized Obama, the man might have got saved. Because he said, before we get to somebody preaching the gospel, the first thing I want you to do is pray. Before we get to somebody campaigning to get one guy out and the other guy in, I just want to know, have you interceded on behalf of those that are over you in the church and outside the church? You know something? Lost people can do petitions. Lost people can do campaigns. Lost people can do commentary. Lost people can do radio and TV programs. Only saved people can get into the presence of God in the power of the Lord Jesus Christ and ask the Almighty Creator to turn the heart of the King. And if all we do is what lost people can do, we've not done the first primary thing that's at our disposal. Some of you like Trump, some of you don't like Trump, some of you say, I like him, but I don't like things he says, and I like some of the things he said. Okay, that's, we could talk about that all night long. Have you prayed for a man who twice has looked in a camera and given the gospel to the world? Have you prayed for a man who has appointed professing Christians who speak up for Jesus Christ to his cabinet? I mean, before you run him out of town because he does some things you don't like, when's the last time you had a man who could give you his testimony of salvation as your vice president? It's so easy to criticize the pastor. It's so easy to criticize the principal. It's so easy to criticize the governor. God said, the first thing I want you to do is pray for those that are in authority. And if we haven't done that, we're as out of line as the people we're criticizing. We have this incredible power at our disposal when it comes to our government, when it comes to our church. We got some men that are deacons who are biblically qualified to be deacons. Praise the Lord. We got some men who are deacons that know this Bible and are trying to live by this Bible. It'd be a shame if half a church or more never prayed to God for them, but as soon as they did something questionable, talked among themselves about, well, I don't know why they made that decision. I don't know, we might have got more than two. I don't know. I saw we have two new doors in the back. And somebody has probably already said, why did we get metal doors? Somebody's probably already said, why did we get doors with those kind of locks? Several of you already said, why is it locked? Who cares what kind of door it is? I can't get through it anyway. I'm telling you, it is automatic to send forth some kind of criticism to whoever was in charge and whoever made a decision. Why isn't it automatic to pray for them? God said, first of all, before you tell your brother or sister how out of line your parents were, when's the last time you prayed for God to help mom and dad do a better job of being mom and dad? Verse number two goes on to say this. Now look, I'm going to show you something. I've preached this way. I've heard it this way all my Christian life. For kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life. But look at verse one. For all men, semicolon, for kings and all their authority, semicolon, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. I pray for the leaders of our nation that they will leave the church alone so we can live a quiet and peaceable life. But that's not the big picture in this context. I pray for the authority figures locally. I pray for the leaders of our church and other churches that we can have peace among ourselves. But that's not the primary focus and direction in the big picture of the context. Think about it. Let's just pick Obama and Trump. Okay? Obama and Trump. They're common to all of us. Do you know how many hours of your life you spend agitated because you're talking about or thinking about the leadership in the White House? And God says, you could have been quiet. You could have been peaceable. You chose to agitate yourself by complaining about things you had no control over when you could have been praying to me on behalf of those men, and I would have put peace in your heart. I would have quieted you down. See, we're wanting God to change the king or change the emperor so my life is smooth and peaceful. And God said, I want you to stop being so discontented and spend more time talking to me so your life can be quiet and peaceable. Because quite honestly, millions of people in America enjoyed 8 years of Obama. While a lot of us were torn out of the frame by it. And millions of people in America right now are enjoying the Trump administration, while others are losing their minds. And you know what? When it's all done, none of our side had any influence on Obama. And none of that side seems to be able to phase Trump. But you know what happens? A lot of people just get ulcers and take nerve pills and yell at their wife and throw things at the TV. And God said, you could have had a quiet and peaceable life. You just decided to yell at a man that wasn't listening when you could have talked to a God who is. I have a long list of suggestions for Donald Trump. And I don't think he cares. I had an even longer list of suggestions for Mr. Obama, and I know he didn't care. But I could go and talk to God. Now, let's look at the third verse after we look at one again. Verse 1, for all men. Verse 2, for kings. Verse 2, for all that are in authority. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come under the knowledge of the truth. First of all, come on, are you saved? You're saved. Believe in heaven, believe in hell. Okay, so let me ask you something. Should you really be praying for Obama to lean to the right? Or should you be praying for his precious, never dying soul to be saved by the blood of Jesus Christ? You know what God wants? He wants Barack Obama to be saved. He wants Michelle Obama to be saved. He wants Donald Trump to be saved. I think he is. Okay, fine. If he is, God wants him saved. God wants his devout Roman Catholic wife to be truly, genuinely saved and born again. That's what God wants. You don't know if God wants them left or right. You don't know if God wants them liberal or conservative. You don't know if God wants them to straighten out America or push it over the cliff. You don't know that. You know he wants them to be saved. There's 50 governors in the United States. God wants every one of them saved and their spouses. And their mistresses. He does. But that guy right there, they ought to run that guy out of office on what he did. Look, some of us would agree, some of us disagree. You're not going to agree with everybody on what the governor should do, what the mayor should do, what the county council should do, what the pastor should do. Context. You know what God wants? He wants all men to be saved. And if we have this great, I don't want to say weapon in the wrong way, this great, powerful means of moving men to Christ, and we don't use it because all we do is what the lost people do, criticize the leaders, argue against the leaders or argue for the leaders. Jesus Christ didn't go to that cross so we could stack a court. Now, look, as a citizen, I got my views. I want a court that's, you know, strict constitutional and you know, pro-God and pro-Bible and all that. That's what I want. When you say that to several hundred people, that's not what everybody here wants. Ooh, it doesn't matter. I'm telling you, there is a point of agreement we should all have. We want all of our senators to be saved. We want all of our school principals to be saved. We want all commanding officers to be saved. That's why Christ went to the cross, so people could be saved. I vote. I encourage you to vote. I try to know enough about things to vote intelligently. I don't know if I do or not. But that is not what a church is to be wrapped up in. We're to be wrapped up in the salvation of souls. Look at verse number 5. For there's one God. There's one God for Republicans, Democrats, atheists, infidels, Buddhists, Muslims. They don't know it, but we know it. There's one God. And one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself, now watch this, who gave himself a ransom for all. Now look at verse 1. Prayers be made for all men. See that? Calvin's just wrong. Calvinists are just wrong. Jesus Christ died for all men. Because he wants all men to be saved. And he wants us to pray for all men. Right? Look, everybody's got different views on this thing, what it means to pray in Jesus' name, and just we say, in Jesus' name, I pray, amen. And I'm not saying don't do that. But you can say, God, make me young again and make me a millionaire in Jesus' name, amen, and you're wasting your breath. It's not a blank check. In Jesus' name, to pray in Jesus' name means I'm going to go to Jesus with this prayer, but if it's not something he's bought into, he's not taking it to the Father. Now, you know what? You can like me or not like me over this. I hope you get over it. But there are a few things I've prayed about as fervently in the last however many years I can remember, as I prayed for God to spare our nation from that woman that was running for president. Because everything I know about her and read about her and heard her say with her own mouth, she's as close to being the devil incarnate as you can be. That's my opinion. That might not be your opinion. Some of you might have voted for her. That's why we don't bring that kind of stuff up. Because it divides people over things that aren't matters of Bible doctrine, though I think that one would be a matter of Bible doctrine. Anyway, but do you know Jesus Christ, if he tonight, if I went to the Lord and I said, I want you to break Hillary Clinton's vocal cords so she can never speak again, that might be my will. I don't think he's taken that prayer to the Father. Unless he already did on his own. I don't Okay, let me stay on track here. If I pray tonight, God expose to the world all the rotten things the Clintons have ever done, that might absolutely not be God's will. You understand? I don't know that. If I go to God tonight and I say, God, Jesus Christ, your son died for Bill and Hillary Clinton, and you don't want them to go to hell. I don't want them to go to hell. God, would you please open their hearts to the gospel and save their souls? You know what that is? That is praying in Jesus' name, because that's what he wants. Now, I'm going to get to how you feel about what I just said in a second. In fact, you want me to go ahead and jump ahead? Look at verse 8. I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lift up holy hands without wrath and doubting. God said, I don't care how angry you are with that king and his policies, I want you to pray for him. And I don't care how impossible you think it is for that person to ever be saved, I want you to pray for them. Well, I'm not praying for Obama after what he did to our country without wrath. I don't see any way that man could ever get saved, and doubting. That's what he said. Because you know what? There's some people didn't think some of you would ever get saved. And there's some people that aren't too happy about some of you going to heaven. If that guy's going to heaven, right? Everybody in the world's not in favor of you walking on gold streets forever. You see that in this context? You got family members, you can't stand them. Jesus Christ wants to save them and give them eternal life. He said, I want you to put your wrath aside and pray for them. There are people you've witnessed to and witnessed to and witnessed to, and you've given up, and you doubt it's done any good at all. You know what God said? I don't care if you doubt or not. I want you to pray. How about that? I doubt you could go to the northern extremities of Sierra Leone and see Muslims trust Jesus Christ as their Savior. But it sure was worth praying for. There they are. You wouldn't have said 10 years ago that cabinet officials and high-ranking members of our government would be meeting for prayer and Bible study in the Capitol building and in the White House. But it's happening. Oh yeah, see, they passed some of the laws they passed. Look, I don't see a lot of things. God said, just reach up to me. Just reach up to me. Say, God help the pastor. God help the deacons. God help the leaders of our church. God help the people run our town. God help the people run our state. God help the people run our country. God help the people sit sit as judges in our courtrooms. And God, most of all, save their souls so they don't have to go to hell. In Jesus' name, because you know that's his will. He so proved it was his will by dying for them. See, here's what we do. Doctrinally, see, here's my doctrine. Who Jesus died for? All men. Jesus went to the cross, he died for the elect, everybody. Where do you get that? First Timothy, Christ died for all men. Okay, so who do we pray for? Who does God want to save? Well, all men. Okay, how about the king? Well, not him. How about them that are in authority? Well, not them. When Paul wrote to Romans, he's writing to all the saved people, and he said, and they of Caesar's household. I don't think that was a very nice household. Caesar's household probably did some things the Kennedys never even thought of doing. But the gospel got there with prayer behind it, and people in that house got saved. How about that? Now, maybe if they'd thrown your family into the dungeon or executed some of your kinfolk or sold your daughters into slavery, maybe you wouldn't be too happy about them being forgiven by God and going to heaven. See what the Lord said? Whatever happened to your family, look at what happened to my family. My son was crucified so they could be saved. Don't you tell me who deserves it, doesn't deserve it. Don't you tell me about how you were mistreated. They spit in my son's face. He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. They nailed him to a cross. I mean, come on. When you tell God, I don't want that person saved because they did me wrong, the only reason we're saved is because they did his son very, 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 very wrong. You know what God had to do to save you? Lay aside his wrath. How about that? There's a lot of people in power in our country. I don't like anything they do. I don't like anything about them. I can't think of one commendable virtue that I've ever heard of in their entire life. Why do we rejoice when we hear about a death row inmate being saved? But we wouldn't feel the same way about the powerful leader of another political party being saved. Well, because the guy on death row didn't do it to you. Those politicians did it to you. See, my problem is I have a hard time praying for people because I can't put me aside. For all men. You got people you go to church with, you've scratched them off the prayer list because they did something to you? There it is. All right. Now look, verse 1. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, giving thanks be made for all men. Now look at verse 7 or 6. Who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. Whereunto I am ordained a preacher and an apostle, I speak the truth in Christ, I lie not, and a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and verity. You know what you got? Here's the fact that Christ died for all men. Here's a man going out to preach that to all men. And God said, before I get there, if you will have prayed for all men, my chances of success go up tremendously. I've really been trying to figure this out. I have. I've really been trying to figure this out. We're down on Friday afternoon, way down. People participating, trying to reach the lost. We're down on Saturday evening, way down. Church Street, we used to have a van full and another car following. Now it's two people, three people. Way down. Door knocking, way down. You know what's going to get you back out there? You start praying for people that are lost and going to hell and begging God to save them. He's going to take you from verse 1 and put you in verse 7. Yes, sir. You start praying for people that Jesus Christ died for, and you start praying for people to be saved. You know what the Lord's going to do? He's going to ordain you a preacher. How can you pour out your heart to God and say, God, they're lost and Jesus died for them. God, they got to be saved, and not get stirred up inside to go and tell them. You know what he said? He didn't say, first of all, get out there and preach. He put that in verse 7. He said, first of all, pray for them. If we'll start praying more for lost people, our feet will get back walking where they ought to walk.
Amen.
Get that burden in your heart. I can plead, I can threaten, I can schedule, I can complain, I can... But God get in your heart. God will get in your heart and you start praying for all men. Verse 8, I will therefore, I just don't know what God's will is for my life. I will therefore that men pray everywhere. You can't preach everywhere. You can't preach at work. It's not what they hired you to do. You can pray there. You can't preach in school. You got to listen to the teacher, not disrupt the class. You can pray there. There's not a place you can't pray. They can outlaw a lot of stuff. They can't outlaw praying. This, you can't distribute literature over here. You can't preach over here. You can't go through this gated community and knock on doors over here. You pray everywhere. Pray everywhere. I will afford men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands. Makes you question your hands, but how about now? some of you have heard this so many times, but right, first time I read that, I'm reading through the New Testament, never read through it before. First time I read through it, I read that verse. So the next Thursday night, when church time came, it was prayer meeting, and they started praying, I put my hands up. Isn't that what it says? Lift up holy hands, not wrath and doubting. And as soon as that service over, I had one of my meetings with the deacons, and the guy tapped me on the shoulder, and he's, I want to talk to you. So I went over there. He said, yeah. I said, what were you doing? I said, what do you mean, what were you doing? Well, you had your hands up and we were praying. What are you doing? How did you know I had my hands up when we were praying? I said, well, you don't know? Let me show you. I'm so naive, I thought he'd never read the verse. But he had. And I showed him the verse and he said, we don't do that here. I said, well, we should. It's right here in the Bible. Which is what every deacon wants to hear from a 19-year-old kid with long hair, you know. And he said, we don't do that here. And I said, can I ask you a question? Do we not do it because it's not right by the Bible, or do we not do it because the charismatic churches do it? And he said, we don't do it because the charismatic churches do it. I'm not encouraging people to be in rebellion, but I've never been able to knuckle under that kind of nonsense. I wasn't shouting in tongues or anything. I'm just doing what a verse said. Now, when it says, I will pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands, I would wait for the red light. I don't know if I'd want to do it going down I-95 and trying to get here from work at whatever mile per hour you feel comfortable with. Honey, look, it's one of them self-driving cars. No, he's just praying. And you don't, look, we're not, you don't want to pray to be seen of men. Hey, guys, watch this. You know what these little ones do when they want to be carried? You know what these little ones do when they want to get close to you? Grandma or mom, hardly ever dad, but they, right? They just lift up those innocent little hands. What God said, just reach up. Tell me you want me to pick you up. Just reach up. Tell me you want to get closer. Lifting holy hands without wrath and doubting. One last point. What if it's not my wrath toward Barack and Michelle? What if it's not my doubts that God could ever save a man that has lived like Donald Trump? What if I'm mad at God for not answering some of those supplications? What if I'm mad at God for not responding to some of those prayers I prayed? You know what the Lord said? I want you to come and pray to me and stop holding my wisdom against me. Because if I haven't answered one of your prayers, it's because it shouldn't have been answered. And if I haven't given you something you asked for, it's because I know it would have hurt you. Now put aside your wrath and come talk to me. You know how many people in this town are mad at God? A lot of them. You know why they're mad at God? Because they asked him for something and didn't get it. He said, put that wrath aside. And doubting. Can I be honest with you? Prayer's... I struggle with prayer. I do. I struggle with prayer. God, Lord said, you know, that woman came, knocked on that door and asked for bread, and that guy didn't want to give it to her, but he gave it to her just because he wanted to get back to sleep. Only thing that makes sense to me is God never needs to sleep, so that, because there's things I've been knocking and knocking and knocking and knocking, and he hadn't thrown that bread down yet. And so I have to go to the Lord, and I say, Lord, you told me to pray without doubting. You told me to come in faith believing. But it's hard for me to do because I don't know what your will is. I don't know what's best. So God, I'm not here to order you. I'm not here to demand you. And I doubt whether or not I'm praying right. But I don't have any doubts that you answer right. And I'm telling you, some of you, your prayer life's not what it used to be because something's happened to make you doubt whether or not God answers your prayers. You know what he said? Without wrath and without doubting. You got to pray like it's the first time you've ever prayed. You can't be influenced in tonight's prayers by what you perceive to be a lack of sufficient answer to last year's prayers. Not wrath or doubting. Let's just, on big scale, national scale. Most of you here, you're very conservative people. You're very old school people. Tell me 3 years ago, you were certain and confident before God that he was going to give you a president that spoke up for Christianity and the Bible and Jesus Christ. And you couldn't have prayed that prayer without doubting. You know what God said? I want you to stop coming to me having figured out what I'm going to do or not going to do or shouldn't do. I just want you to come to me and pray for all men to be saved. Because that's what I want. Who would have prayed in Jeremiah's day, Dear God, I just want you to get a hold of Nebuchadnezzar's heart and send him in here to bring us into captivity. When Jeremiah said, Nebuchadnezzar's God's servant, he's going to come in here and carry you off to Babylon, they threw him in the dungeon. That doesn't sound right. How could that be right? So I'm not going to go to God and tell him who he needs to put in office and not put in office and I'm going to go to God and ask him to save Governor Scott and his family. Wouldn't it be great if they got saved? Wouldn't it be great if Pelosi and her husband got saved? Wouldn't that be something? They got saved and gave the $800 million they've stolen to missions. Why are you praying for to go to jail? Pray for to get saved in jail. You understand where we are tonight? It is so easy to talk about people in authority. We just do it like Christians. It's so easy to look. Whoever is in charge of anything, you can criticize them. You can find fault with whoever throws the baby shower for not doing something the way you would have done it. Right? Just goes with the territory. God said, I want you to pray for them because my son died for them. So when somebody preaches to them, it'll have an effect. Amen. Father, if we got a weak spot as a church, we're on it right here tonight. As a group, as individuals. Lord, we can see everything that's wrong with everybody, we think. But you see it, and you want to save them. You see it, and you want to give them everlasting life. Lord, help us to see things the way you see them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing. The altar's open. Some people are here already.